welcome to our communication special webinar series called Sanchar.next. Today's topic of discussion is devising a new communication strategy in the wake of a pandemic. Starting with a big thanks to our sponsor, Communicate India, a 360 degrees brand solutions and PR firm, which handles clients across verticals like HR, corporate, health, real estate, and lifestyle. I am Rahul Puri, editor of Agency Reporter, and joining me today on this discussion are Vikram Chandra, founder of Editor G. In his earlier avatar, Vikram was one of India's best known TV news anchor, presenting shows like The Big Fight, 9 O'Clock News, and Gadget Guru on NDTV. Carson Dalton, he is the senior director of Ola Mobility Institute. Carson was the founding head of communications for Facebook in India, where he also supported the growth of WhatsApp, Instagram, and Messenger in India and South Asia. Akshara Lalwani, founder of Communicate India. She is a communications connoisseur, first of her kind, who has worked across 20 sectors with over 350 companies, personally refining her craft to create the new order in marketing and communications. A recorded version of this webinar will also be available for next few days, pinned to our YouTube and social media channels. It will always be available on our website, agencyreporter.com, in the Editor's Take section. Now, without further ado, I'll turn the time over to Akshara, who will be moderating the session and has some really interesting questions to ask. Over to Akshara.
Thank you. Thank you, Rahul. First of all, I'd like to thank the lovely two leaders here, Vikram and Carson, who both come from our innovators in their own right. Starting with Vikram, I'd love to know, you know, you've always spoken about television. You've had a historic legacy about in the television space. And television really is at a crossroads. And, you know, you invested in digital and you think digital is the future. What's the real deal? You know, what do you think the consumer is really looking for?
Thanks a lot, guys. Thanks, Akshara, for throwing that to me. And, you know, that's a subject I could probably talk on for like 1 hour. So I'm going to try and keep it relatively short. I think it's been obvious to many of us for a fairly long period of time that television news is facing a bit of a crisis. In fact, in general, video news is facing a bit of an issue for a simple reason that the form factors and others aren't completely keeping up with the times. Now, if you take television news, what is happening? You're chasing TRPs. That's because you don't get subscription around money. You're paying carriage fees. You're chasing advertising. Advertising comes from TRPs. To get TRPs, you've got to do debates and you've got to yell and shout at people. That's how you get TRPs. If you don't want to be watching yelling and screaming, or if you're a brand that says, I don't necessarily want my brand to be sitting in the middle of three fine gentlemen and maybe a couple of ladies all yelling at each other, it doesn't really give you too much of an option, because that's what television news requires. Which is why if you ask a large number of people, okay, right now there's a lockdown, so people are at home, maybe they're watching more TV news than they once used to. But if you ask a lot of people, they will be telling you, we don't watch that much TV news. Even now, I get, you know, every week I'll come across 2, 3, 4 people who come to me and say, oh, we see you on TV every day. And I say, you couldn't be, because I quit television like years ago. And they say, oh yeah, actually you're right. I've never bahut mahino se television nahi. So actually, kai saalon se humne TV news nahi dekha. So that just sort of shows that there's a vacuum there. Now, digital has its own set of issues. I've always felt the form factor is not appropriate. If you want 30 pieces of news, you're not going to tap on 30 different icons on a digital screen to get the news that you want. So what we figured out is that the right thing to do is to create 20, 30 small stories. Give people the information they need in 20-second bits. Use AI to assemble them together into personalized newscasts for individual people. So then you're giving people part of the news that they should see. Those are the big headlines and other things. And part of the news that fits their own interest. And you use AI to combine it all. And then it is as easy to access and easy to use as switching on television is. You just tap a button and your news will start. And the model for this, obviously, we took was partly from the music industry. That's what we're all familiar with in Spotify and Apple Music. You know, that's the way it works. So yeah, that's the potted version. As I said, I could go on talking about it for an hour. But
fantastic. No, I like that, Vikram. I think, Carson, let's ask you, so how much news are you watching and how much digital information are you consuming? What's the ratio? Let's hear from you.
So I have a confession to make. I haven't watched television in a year. And the only time I watched television... Yeah. Funnily, it's just to sort of break the odd silence. I'm consuming my news from my mobile phone from apps. So if I've got to catch something on an NDTV or BBC or CNBC, I'm going to catch it from their pages, which I subscribe to. And what am I seeing most? I'm seeing video. I also agree with Vikram that everything is bite-sized now. If there's anything about 8 to 10 minutes, it sort of puts me off. So I want to read and I want to watch everything between 4 to 5 minutes. Obviously, the headline, if it's catchy, even knowing that I shouldn't be clicking on it, I still go. Just closing in on the point, I haven't watched television. It's there. I think, if we use it, it's now just to sort of for the kids to watch YouTube. And if I want to catch up on Netflix and Prime. And I just think during the pandemic, we've sort of gone back to television just to sort of keep up. Because, I just think holding a mobile phone 24/7 isn't as healthy as it should be. But I don't know what's going to be the future of the television now in its form of how we've been watching and consuming content over the years, and specifically news.
So, Akshara, if I can...
Fantastic. Sorry.
If I could pinch your job just for a minute or two and just ask him a question. Let me just take that thought forward, exactly what you said, right? When you are experiencing the news by going to particular sites and you want to find the right piece of information, that's where the challenge, according to me, will come. See, now, if it is text news that you want, it's very easy to find the stories. Why? Because you'll scroll up and down, you'll see lots of headlines, and you'll say, okay, I want to watch this. And you'll tap on that. Now, let's try and translate that to video, because the real crisis in digital is not in text, it's in digital video news. Now, if you want to watch video, and you want 30 stories which are all bite-sized, I would venture to say that today you will find it very difficult to find. You will either watch a live television news channel on your mobile phone, which defeats the purpose. If you want to watch live television, you might watch it on a TV screen, but watch it on a mobile. Or you'll find lots of little stories. And if you want to watch 5-6 of them, it's a pain to go and tap on 5 tabs. So what we're doing is we're giving you that 5 minutes. We assemble 30 stories into a nice personalized playlist for you.
So Vikram, I don't think it's difficult. I think it's impossible to find video stories, right? Yeah. If someone tells me, hey, did you catch the Berkshire Hathaway earnings conference 2 days ago? You should have watched it. And I'm like, okay, where? You just basically go into a search bar and then you look for the story. But if someone is, an AI is looking at the pattern of news, views and other content that I want to consume, and if it's Editor G, which is then giving me those 20 stories a day just the way I'm getting text, hallelujah, I think, that's definitely secret sauce for bringing people back to content, or bringing people back to a platform which serves their viewing interest.
Yeah.
Fantastic. And because I know for a fact that I have so many questions and I have limited time, and I know we want to keep it bite-sized and interesting, I thought that, people have been talking continuously about fake news. There could be a guy with a burger and a shake down the line putting up news which is not factually correct. And it's really starting to affect the consumer and creating this fear and paranoia, which, I think we have a pandemic. I don't think we need more fear or paranoia than that's there. So I'm going to ask you, Vikram, and obviously from the brand side, Kasim, to tell me a little bit more about how are you at Editor G going to make sure that this is not, the content is verified, you have the right people working for you who are wearing this information, it's just not lifted. A lot of wire agencies have also had challenges, a lot of companies have faced challenges of fake news. And can you delve a little bit more deeper of rather than talking about the problem, what's the solution and what are you guys doing at your end at the brand level and at the editor level to sort of manage that?
So that's exactly, in many ways, what you have just said is the core USP of what we are trying to do. Editor G has now 70 people, 60, more than 60 trained journalists, some of the best video news professionals in the business are working there. What's their job? Their job is to get the information and put it into these 20-second bite-sized units, which are all authentic and verified. The partners we work with are also companies like Hindustan Times or Boom or others, but Databas are all again verified and who do a lot of work in making sure what they're putting out is correct. Now, where I think the problem is coming is that we tend to get news and information based on WhatsApp forwards or somebody in a kai and somebody's put something out and all of that. So I don't think citizens, I don't think journalism is something that should be citizen journalism in that sense, that people with a phone, anybody can put out, this is what they do.
Right.
And you need a level of verification, and that's what we provide. What Heritage allows you to do is you can create your own playlists of authentic, verified stories. We allow people to add their opinion to that and put it out. But we have a differentiation between the facts, which professionals verify, and opinions, which anyone's entitled to. And as long as you make the demarcation, this is a fact and this is an opinion, that's fine.
Having watched...
Fantastic. Carson, would you like to add something?
Yeah. Akshar, so just sort of picking up, I think there's... Vikram's talked about the journalism side of it. And having worked at Facebook and WhatsApp and watched the space grow, and when I say grow in terms of just the conversation around fake news and misinformation, it has moved in the right direction from a product and communication standpoint. Now, when I talk about product, I think specifically organizations at a product level have, and perhaps it's late, but late nonetheless, and better late than never, have made product changes and iterations which limit the spread of fake news. There have been, and there is a concerted effort in putting together these collectives of organizations that can fact check. That said, there's also been a lot of communication which and awareness which has gone out on behalf of platform companies, on behalf of the government, and also on behalf of just the ecosystem. Now, even a consumer brand today is aware that they need to sort of go out there and kill and demystify any fake news that is being carried out against their brand or service, or if there's any misinformation. And I think all today, people are a lot more aware, you know, to check, is this news right? So what are the few things, I mean, if let's just take simple example, right? I get an SMS, I get a WhatsApp forward or a message saying X has happened. And I'm like, how do I verify it? So I'll go and check one or two other websites. I'll go to the search bar, perhaps make a phone call and sort of assimilate and see, is this right or is this wrong? And I think a lot of this is beginning to take place. If I had to rewind about 24 months back, a lot of people would have just fallen flat to the rumor and speculation and mongering that is this thing. So there's a lot that has to get done and be done in this space. But I think, you know, water has flown positively under the bridge.
Fantastic. What a question. Another area, you know, I mean, everybody is sort of taking the sustainable route. It's, you know, it's something where people are saying every organization should have a higher purpose. And I have two questions here. Carson, what do you think? I mean, when you're talking about mobility, do you think personally, what are the learnings of you thinking of government relations, advocacy, mobility going in the future? How do you protect consumer interest? You know, what are your learnings, or what would you share are, you know, areas that you've come to find important or a pivotal point right now?
That's an interesting question from a perspective of we've seen the rise of social partnerships in the last 60 odd days, where governments, traditional companies, and even platform companies, gig economies have come together to stitch up partnerships of sort of supporting, large populations where this wouldn't have ordinarily taken place. The public policy landscape in India and globally is witnessing a gradual return of social politics, or politics that is sensitive to social activism. And what we are seeing is the rise of social license. Now, social license is wider than the need for an organization to act lawfully, ethically, or in a socially responsible manner. Today, with the pandemic, organizations are looking at not only regulatory permission, but also social permission to conduct their business. And that's what we're going to see post-pandemic. There are many examples where, you know, the absence of social license has resulted in project delays and cancellations. And so as we move forward, brands and organizations will require community consent. It's good. While it's not an absolute, they will require a social license to sort of move center stage in discussions on how their activities are legitimate in the eyes of society and in a globalized economy. So if one asks the question, what does social license entail, right? It starts with an organization having to regard the views and interests of a broader range of stakeholders, not just shareholders, but this incorporates the notion of also trust and compliance and community standards.
Right. And Vikram, I mean, coming back to this, you know, we've all spoken about smartphone penetration. It's still, I mean, of course, it's growing massively, but there's still two-thirds of our population which still need to go into the smartphone direction when we're talking about the density that we do have. So, of course, there's news is an essential, I would say, is an essential service, right? But you also have additional costs like infrastructure, you know, steam costs, you know, SEO costs, etc., to make sure you get there. So how do you keep that balance of making sure an essential service reaches out to the broader audience of people, but is also at a fair price, you know, and keeping the interest of larger community at large?
In our case, there are two, three things. Number one, we have a very tight rein on costs. So the way, one of the key things that we've been able to do at Editergy, I think, is redefine the price point at which we're generating. We're doing 200 video news stories a day. And our price and our cost for doing those 200 video news stories a day is a fraction of what it is, I think, just for what anybody else. That's one thing. And second, I believe that the overall business models in any case are going to start changing, because people are going to start realizing information is a public good. That is right. It is good to get that information out there. At some point, brands also will start realizing that being associated with good quality information or good quality areas of social interest. I mean, in my early avatar, I spent a lot of time working on programming for social interest, like the Greenathon or Save My the Tiger or Support My School, or, you know, campaigns like that. Each one of them, I thought, had a massive impact on the brands also. So that's an example of how you come together with a brand. There's a good cause, or just the cause of spreading good quality information. And you work together with the brands and think, let's do this. But that means working in a partnership mode, as opposed to brands also taking the easy or the lazy way out, which is just to say, hey, aapke TRP kya hai, aapke clicks kitne hai, aapka programmatics lenge, and you push it out. Now, that's the easy way of doing it, right? And you've got some numbers to back it. But is that necessarily the best long-term solution? No. It means working in partnership with media and other companies to find the correct solutions for what you want to.
Vikram, can you tell me a little bit about, you know, how would you be doing native advertising more responsibly? You know, brands obviously, you know, the challenge that we face as communications professionals, sometimes they want things verbatim. Sometimes it's, you know, really, really bold comments, which are hard to justify. So how do you think, you know, you'd be bridging the gap to give the brand value, share of voice, but also being responsible through the native advertising route?
So we have a very different structure that we are working out, which is essentially around the pieces of content that we have, which are factual, and therefore there's no issue with that. And after that, we do use a lot of AI and other methods to give the brands. Then it's we are in the business of information, right? So what we help brands do is find a solution. And again, we do use a lot of AI and ML for that. That if a brand, for example, had launched a particular product, and that's a piece of information. It's not, we have no problems in, nobody should mind seeing that. That's a piece of information. So-and-so launched a new phone. That's great. What we are working on are solutions where once that piece of information has been shared with someone, if someone wants more information on that thing, okay, let me know something more about this particular product. How does that translate into additional information to aid in the buying decision? That's where companies like ours can play a very, very important role. And that's a big area that we are working on.
Vikram, anything you'd like to add, you know, because you are an entrepreneur, you've had a great career, I've you know, read all up. Is there anything that you'd advise other entrepreneurs, other communications professionals, brands, you know, because there's so much going on here, it's really hard to grapple of what we should take and what we shouldn't.
So I think the only major thing that I would want to say is to say that, look, I think we are in an era of revolutionary changes. And to my mind, that revolutionary change was going to be coming because of technology. The role of technology in changing a bunch of things was always going to be very, very prominent. I think what's happened with the pandemic is it's accelerated change. It's accelerated, look at the sort of ways in which we're doing these conversations. It made things move much faster. I think we've got to be prepared to tear up everything that we once believed was bhai aise karna chahiye, or this is the way this thing works, or this is the way that thing works. It was already going to change. It was already going to change. But I'm glad that that transition has been accelerated. And I just want to end perhaps by giving a little bit of an insight from, you know, like if you take my life itself, when I was coming back to India, after being doing college, journalism at that time basically meant go and get into print. And I said, but print is going to end and television is going to come. And people said, there's no TV, there's no broadcast journalism in India. It does not exist. It will never exist. But you got to, I said, let's try it. Why will it not work in India? Similarly, in 1999, 2000, when I was telling people, let's start doing ndtv.com, people used to say, you know, digital may or may not work. So I think you've got to be prepared. If there's this cycle keeps happening, and you may not think that things are going to change, or you may not think this is the right way to do it, but you'll be surprised at how fast things can change. And the pandemic is going to accelerate.
I caught some of Vikram's comments. This brings me to an article I read by Ruchi Sharma from Morgan Stanley last week. And he says the pandemic isn't changing everything. It is just speeding up trends that were already underway. And what we're going to see is, again, just things speeding up. This is more of a response to what parts of what I talked about Vikram was saying earlier.
Fantastic. And, you know, I think, like we spoke about bite-sized information, I think we've had a really engaging conversation. And what I want to ask, the same question I asked Vikram, is that there's so much there, you know, as a brand custodian, Carson, you know, as a consumer of news, as someone who's been in the industry for a while across different companies, can you, you know, tell brands, communications professionals, journalists, etc., what would you say would be information you should take, because everyone's so overwhelmed of what they should or should not be doing? Do you have any quick learnings that you have that you'd like to share with everyone?
Yeah, a few. And I think communications is, everyone's realized the power of communications, you know, and how you need to communicate effectively during this pandemic that has happened. Everything from a basic hygiene in terms of communication, the government downwards, global organizations, organizations communicating with employees and various stakeholders. So, if there was any doubt in the mind of the power of communications, it's front and center. Secondly, is about technology. Again, going back to the comment which was made by Ruchir, in terms of trends of accelerating and embracing technology, if organizations were thinking about embracing cloud-based services or work from home, technology is just going to speed up those trends which were anyways underway. So organizations should look at going digital fully, should look at embracing the cloud. Thirdly, again, I think it's the power of video. If anyone doubted that, you know, I don't think our networks can take it, more from a network management standpoint, or what is this going to do in terms of communication? Video is here to stay. I just think we're going to look at different ways in which it can be used and effective. I'm sure all of us still want to meet physically and collaborate. And I think all of that will happen. But we've just got to now embrace a video first world.
I think there's great learning from technology, Carson. I think it's invaluable. I think the learnings are here. On about too many learnings, I think, Vikram and Carson, I really appreciate you doing this. Over to you, Rahul.
That was, I think, a very fulfilling session. Thank you, everyone, for taking out time from busy schedules and joining us today for the webinar. We appreciate all of you being here. Thank you again for joining us, and we'll see you next time.
Bye. Thank you for having us. Bye-bye.